This morning I spoke about spiritual blocking. And I just felt the need today to share with you just a thought about that. Before the services in the morning at 9:30, it's for 10 o'clock service, and at 5 o'clock service, we've decided to start to pray in the chapel. And I encourage you, if you'd like to come to the chapel at 4:30 before a cup of coffee, or I know you might be practicing music and so on, but you'll see people huddled in there, and you're just welcome to come in as we pray for the anointing of the Spirit and for God to do His work here in our midst. I am struck by the things that create blocks in our life. That we may be walking with God to the best of our ability, but yet there are still these, what I call, spiritual blocks. And how Christ is the one who breaks through into our lives. The story this morning that was shared, was briefly put, was a rich man who came to Jesus and asked, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" It was taken from Mark 10. And the problem was that this man was exceptionally wealthy. Jesus turned to him, and I have a picture of Jesus, maybe if I could put that up. And that's quite a powerful image of Christ. It's if you look at his eyes, I'm struck. This is the picture I have on my computer when I open up my computer, of a God who wants to accept me where I am, but wants to take me someplace. He's not necessarily prepared. He's prepared to love me where I am, but he also wants to redeem my life and take me someplace. And I think we're afraid of being taken places. And it's one of the reasons we put up spiritual blocks. The wealthy man in Mark 10, when Jesus confronted him, Jesus, I think, looked at him like this. The text in Mark 10, 21 actually says, "And Jesus loved him, and then Jesus spoke some tough words into his life." Jesus didn't sit down on the floor and hold his hands and say, "I see how you're feeling here." He didn't go there. He turned to the man and he said, "You want to be my disciple? You need to sell all your possessions, take the money, and give it to the poor." And the man walked away from Jesus, sad, grieved, says the text. He was grieved. He walked away because Jesus nailed him at his spiritual block, the place that prevented the growth of the gospel in his life. He's the only man in Scripture where I understand Jesus actually says that. The question is, what are the spiritual blocks in our life? That if you are in depression, if you are in, there could be anger, there's just a myriad of stuff that goes on inside us. That in fact prevent the gospel from coming close. And Jesus wants to unmask those powers within you. So where I'm going today is, as I've been talking about you as individuals, I talked about that primarily in the morning, about individuals and what's going on in your life. I believe it can happen in a community. That there can be a spiritual block over a community of faith. And possibly why some churches grow and some churches don't grow. And they could maybe not grow because the Spirit is being prevented from coming. And so we're looking at Proverbs to a postmodern people. We're looking at James's gospel. Because I think there's some deeply relevant things and in that text. And we're going to look at that right now. And I'm going to encourage you to open up your Bible to James chapter 2. Now, if you didn't bring your own Bible, there's a pew Bible in the pew there for you. And it's page 179, way far on the right side of the Bible, near the end of the Bible. 179 of the New Testament section. And I believe that St. James, who we're reading here, he was actually addressing a spiritual block among the people where he's worshiping. And I think it can apply to us. That's why I'm reading it, and that's why we're taking the time here. I'm going to read a couple places here. I'm going to just go to chapter 1, verses 9 and following, and then jump to chapter 2. He's telling us that the brother, I'm reading from the New International Version, so it's a little different than your pew version, but it goes like this. The brother or sister in humble circumstances ought to take pride in his high position. What's he saying there? Is that because of what Christ has done for you, because your life is redeemed in Christ, I don't care if you are financially impoverished, you have a high position. So take pride, be thankful for the high position you have because of your walk with Christ. And then he goes in verse 10, but the one who is rich should take pride in his low position because he will pass away like a wild flower. We come and go. Everybody comes and goes. So just because you have wealth doesn't make you better than somebody else. Here's the thing. We're going to go to chapter 2. This has become an issue in the church, and before I read it, I'm going to just tell you something. I think what I just told you doesn't seem too radical to you. Does everybody feel that everybody's equal before the throne of God? Does that make sense to you? Does that feel right to you? I hope so, because it's true. It is so true that it's so ingrained in you, you don't even question it. Let me tell you that without 2,000 years of Christianity, you wouldn't be thinking that way. When he writes this, it is so radical. Folks, most of us live in affluent middle class. We don't know what poor really is. When James is writing this, there is rich and there's poor, and there's nobody in between. Pretty much. Okay? The affluent. And you know what was in the minds of the people? You're rich? You must be blessed by God. You got something I don't because you got money, therefore God must like you more than me. That was the thinking of people. And God's changed that in this text. I want to tell you that poverty was the norm for Western Christendom, Western civilization. It took a couple, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years to change it. And that's the kicker and the big change with the Industrial Revolution and the French Revolution. And so this is not a digression of me. I think this is deeply relevant. I just want you to know that as late as the 1700s, late 1700s, early 1800s, it was still the rich and the poor. That's why there were revolutions. That's why there was the British Revolution, the Glorious Revolution. That's why there was the French Revolution. The whole notion of left and right, when we talk politically left and right, that comes out of the French Revolution, from Parliament. The wealthy were the nobility, the blue bloods. They had everything. They were what's called the first estate. The second estate were the clergy, because we controlled everything, the clergy did. And there was this new thing called the rising middle class, the proletariat. And that's what Lenin and all the Marxists and these guys are talking about, but the rising class, and that was called the third estate. And they sat in Parliament, and the third estate sat up, the building was really high. So it sat on the left, that's why we call it the political left. The political right was over here, was the nobility, the power, the clergy. Don't change anything. We've got it all. It was a pretty unenlightened church, a venial church. Okay, it was about power, politics, and money. And up comes this, the Montaignon, the left, the mountain. That's what they were called up here on the left. That was the third estate. I always like to tell people that the fourth estate is what? You know what the fifth estate is? It's a television show, right? Fifth estate, where does it come from? Fourth estate was the press, the written press, the written word. And the fifth estate is TV. First estate is nobility. Second estate. So this, folks, this is all modern. This is all new. This hasn't even been thought of. And all of a sudden, James is talking to an ancient church community. And what set the church apart was that we cared for the poor in a way that nobody else cared for them. It was transformative. And this is why James is so radical. Now, chapter 2. James. My brothers, as believers in the glorious Lord Jesus Christ, do not show favoritism. I think he could be saying here, this is a spiritual block. Suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing a gold ring and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes also comes in. If you show special attention to the man wearing the fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, you stand there or sit on the floor by my feet, have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts? Listen, my brothers and sisters, has not God chosen those who are poor in the eyes of the world to be rich in faith and to inherit the kingdom he promised those who love him? But you have insulted the poor. Is it not the rich who are exploiting you? Are they not the ones who are dragging you into court? Are they not the ones who are slandering the noble name of him to whom you belong? And then he goes on. So, here this text is calling us to care for the poor. And when we don't, and all we think about is ourselves and my own spiritual growth, there's arguably a problem. And so, it is texts like this that bleed all through the scriptures. Okay. Well, Who did Jesus hang out with? Talk to me. Who did Jesus hang out with? Who were his followers? The wealthy? This is, tax collectors were as beneath contempt as anybody. Okay? What did they criticize Jesus of? Hanging out with people of low estate. Who was the first person, arguably, who saw the risen Christ at the garden? Mary, right? Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother. What was Mary Magdalene's profession, folks? What was it? She was a prostitute. How would you feel if you found out that the rector of St. John's, York Mills, was hanging out with prostitutes? Be pretty bad, wouldn't it? We don't want our minister hanging out with prostitutes. But that's the point. We judge it. As I told the story in all seriousness in London, Ontario, this was before cell phones, and I've got my collar on and I'm driving along the 401 and I've got to get into town and I got to phone home. I don't know who I had to phone, but I had to phone somebody. And I drove into town and I just got off the ramp and I went to the first thing I saw, and I saw a Bell telephone booth, right? It was at a strip joint. Now the question is, do I park my car in the strip joint to get out of the car with my collar on to make a phone call so that parishioners can see the vicar of such and such a church leaving the strip bar. That was a kind of a conundrum I found myself in, huh? But my reputation, you see, I have to rise above it. So what did I do?
Did you take your collar off?
I took my collar off. I took my collar off and I slithered and parked and then I rubbered and took off when I finished my call because I didn't want to risk it or explain it. Now what's going on there? Shows you a spiritual block. I am bound by my profession. I am bound by reputation. And I want you to know that that's not something I do, right? But maybe we should. Maybe we should be holding this church service in a bar. Maybe we need to be going out instead of calling people in. Does that make sense? Jesus and James are so radical. They are calling us not to show favoritism. And I don't know. Do we show favoritism? Answer that for me, because maybe I'm blind and I don't see it. Or do we show favoritism in this church? Chris?
Are there any poor among you?
Are there any poor among us? You got some underemployed people for sure, but it's hard.
There are working poor in this congregation. There are homeless in this congregation, but there's a lot of working poor. And I'd say in a congregation like this, people like that high, and that adds a whole different outcome and shame to the financial issues that are already being
there. So, that's a good question, though. So here's my difficulty is that we have a food bank here on Wednesdays once a month where we invite what's called Barnabas Ministry and your financial offerings. Notice I've not asked you for any financial offerings. There's a collection plate over there and on the wall, and if you care to make an offering, it's a wonderful thing. But if you're a visitor, don't go there. But what I am saying is that there's a ministry that goes on here, and the Barnabas Ministry happens where we feed the poor and the marginalized, and we invite them in. But they never come to worship. They never come to grow and hear the word that will, in fact, change their lives. Because I guarantee you, this word will change lives. It's changed yours, it's changed yours, it's changed mine. It's changed a lot of people who are sitting here. We just don't go stand on a rooftop and talk about how much our lives have been changed by this gospel. Jesus said to the disciples, at the end of Matthew's gospel, we hear him say, go out into the world and make disciples in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Go baptize them. And so I encourage you to look at a sermon that I preached here online on September 23rd in the morning. And it's a pivotal piece of preaching. And if you haven't seen it, I want you, as part of this parish, to take a look at it to know my heart. I feel that God, you were there in the morning that day, but some of you were, but the piece there is that God's calling us to go out and to not show favoritism. That we need to act on this faith. Because if we walk around here saying, I have faith in Jesus and I'm okay, and show no works in keeping with that, then our faith is dead. That's what the text will say in a few more verses. And we'll save that for another Sunday. I've asked Christopher here. Chris Ketch is a student from the University of Toronto seeking ordination. Wave hi so everyone knows you. There you are. There's Chris. Chris has worked with youth, done all number of things, and I've asked him to share the word here in a couple of weeks. But part of the thing is that I've asked him to go out to the Carloop community over here, which is a development of people who are financially struggling. And it's a housing project. And to go and visit this housing project. and find out what, in fact, its needs really are. And I'm hoping as an emissary you're going to come back with the Spirit telling you what you feel, what you're hearing, where we are, and that possibly from this place, we don't just worship Sunday night at 5, but what we do is we go out and meet the needs of those people within our community. Whether it is locally here, or whether we're taking on a project across the world, I believe God is calling us to that. I believe there could be a spiritual block that we are possibly too inward focused and possibly need to look out and look beyond our borders. And that's what we need to pray about. I leave you with this one story that struck me as I visited another church over the summer, and a man who worked at the Young Street Mission downtown. And he has been a Christian, a devout Christian for years. And he works at he's a leader at the Young Street Mission, working with the street people of Toronto, helping them get off the street, feeding them, clothing them, caring for them. And he invited two of his friends to go with him, and they stayed overnight. They went to this event. They went and they helped. And after spending a night there, these two friends came up to him and said, "Where do we get baptized?" They were so touched by his ministry. They saw the faith of Christ in his life working. So much so, they said, "We want to come to your church. We want to start worshiping. We need to get baptized." Now here's the interesting piece. The fellow who worked at the Young Street Mission said, "I have shared my faith with those two guys for years. For years I have been trying to explain who Jesus is to them. And they didn't get it." One night at the Young Street Mission, a 36-hour time visit, their lives were so touched, the penny dropped, they connected the dots and said, "Now I get what this Christianity is. It is building the kingdom of God." I think that's a challenge to us. It challenged my heart. It spoke to my heart. And I pray that that it will shape us as we start to look out and stop, if we are guilty of, discerning between the rich and the poor.